Good afternoon, dear master students. Today you start a dream, and this is a new project of the UTPL. We are really grateful that you have become part of this important program that is called Maestría en Pedagogía para Enseñanza del Inglés como Lengua Extranjera. This course is going to be called Theory for Teaching Grammar. It has 4 academic credits, and my name is Paola Cabrera. I'm going to be in charge of working with you through this first bimester in this important course. The purpose of this presentation is just to explain a little bit about the most relevant theories related with grammar, since EFL teachers now need to know a lot about these approaches, the new methods you can follow in the classroom. The idea of this subject is not to make you memorize topics or memorize rules, but to reflect on the most relevant ones, how to adapt them in the classroom. So we have classified these contents into 4 important units. The first one is related with the perspectives on grammar and teaching and learning. These perspectives have passed through an important process since years ago, so we are gonna review the most relevant approaches and methods that have been used in grammar. Then we will continue with some of the current perspectives on teaching and learning grammar, what is gonna be used in the classrooms today, for example, technology, tools, and this kind of things that can be applied in our classes. Then we will continue identifying the importance of differentiating form, meaning, and use in the classroom, especially for a grammar structure. How to teach the form, why is meaning important, and why is use important for teaching a structure too. And finally, in the last unit, which I think is one of the most practical ones, relates with grammar in language teaching today. You will find some of the difficulties students can face while learning grammar, and also for teachers while they try to teach the language. So, according to the previous units, the course objectives for this first bimester are to review the approaches to the contextualized teaching of grammar, to analyze what is the role of grammar in the traditional language classroom. You as English teachers have had experience with students maybe of different levels, different ages, and will be able to identify them from your own experience. However, this course will provide you with some tips on how to be prepared to control your lessons in a good way. To analyze the importance of teaching the form, meaning, and use of grammar structures in the classroom through practical exercises, especially through activities that you will propose for your lessons. And finally, to prepare lessons, to plan lessons for teaching grammar in a really productive, meaningful, and useful way. The idea here will be you to demonstrate that you are ready, that you can plan in a good way, in a meaningful way, in order for your students to understand the topics and to be able to communicate by your explanations or through the way you teach them. Regarding some of the most recommended guidelines the university usually gives master students, I would like to mention just the most relevant ones, because this is very important for you to be ready to start working with responsibility in this program. Hard work is also an important tool for having success. Discipline and commitment. Why commitment? Because you need, since the beginning, to start working in this process. This is your responsibility. This is a dream you have. So it means that you have to be very responsible in order to be successful. Then it's necessary that you review the text guide and the virtual platform EVA. In this point, I would like to explain that you won't receive any commercial book during this course. However, the text guide concentrates all the aspects that you need to know. However, this is not necessary that you just focus your attention on the guide. You can also find different sources. I included some complementary bibliography and books that you can review digitally on the internet, or maybe printed books as a good complement for the course, because these are just the general guidelines I can give you, but this is not the only thing that you can find about grammar. As for the virtual platform, all of you, I think, have had the opportunity to access SEVA during these days since last week. And we will send you weekly announcements, of course, in some cases more than one announcement, depending on the requirements of the course. However, it's necessary that you please try to be focused on participating a lot, on opening your EVA in order to interact with your classmates, on participating in the forums, to review the useful links I will post for you. There are gonna be some videos related with the class, some chats also, which are gonna be mandatory, as well as the conferences, and interesting explanations. In this part, especially for chats, video conferences, and the forum, those are mandatory activities, plus a wiki that is gonna be incorporated by the end of the course. Very important, and this is recommended in distance education, that the students try to work with a weekly schedule to establish at least a 2 hours a day schedule in order to read, in order to research, in order to work on the assignments. Because if you are leaving everything for the end of the course, you won't have enough time to complete the activities. This is one of the reasons why the program has decided to establish a weekly schedule for sending the essay part of the activities that are gonna be scored over 5 points each one. In this case, you will have to present your first activity, for instance, tomorrow by the end of the day. And this is necessary to read aloud. Additionally, it's recommended to develop the self-assessments at the end of each unit. Why? Because through these self-assessments, you will prove your progress. You will know that you have been learning a lot, or maybe the topics that you need to reinforce while learning each one of the units. If you have any question while trying to develop the assessments, you can just call me and let me know so that I can clarify any doubt you might have. And finally, in this case, to make full use of digital grammar books. Not grammar books related with the way we understand a structure or we use a structure, grammar exercises, not. The idea here is that you as EFL teachers need to know the methodologies, the approaches, the most recommended activities or strategies you can use regarding grammar teaching. And also nowadays, index journals are really important to find information that is relevant, that has been maybe produced recently, as well as online tools, but not any tool, maybe not just using Google to find the answer to your questions. However, there are online tools that have been produced with a good strategy, maybe to prove some methodologies or guidelines that other people from all parts of the world wanna share with us. You can also find dictionaries and spell checkers. Why is this important? Because in your essay, in each one of the essay activities, you need to be careful when spelling the words, especially to connect them clearly and to share with the teacher or classmates a good post or a good piece of writing, a good comment. It's always necessary to use those tools. Another part that is necessary is to reference all the sources you will use when working on the distance assignments, when posting your comments, when sharing information. To do so, It's necessary to use the APA style, the sixth edition. You can find it on the internet. You will find many or different examples about APA citations, because nowadays the university has established this policy about avoiding plagiarism. What is plagiarism? We need to know that plagiarism is using someone else's work or words or ideas or illustrations, published or unpublished. This means that I cannot just copy and paste information from other sources and try to include them in my tasks, in my assignments, in order to demonstrate that I wrote them. No. Students who plagiarize will be graded with zero and won't have any opportunity to rectify that error. In this case, they won't have any opportunity to repeat the assignment, because this is part of the UTPL's policies. So remember, for all of the assignments you are going to work, you need to include the APA citation. Even if this is a small piece of writing, you need to include what were the sources you used. If maybe you found information from an article, from an ebook, or anything, you need to reference and to give the correct credit to the author, okay, that plagiarized, that published that part, in order to avoid being part of this plagiarism that is not so good, especially for a master's student. As for the evaluation system of the course and for all of the courses of this program, the distance assignment will consist on an essay and an objective part. All of the assignments have both parts. In total, they are going to be scored in the following way: 30 points, from which 10 belong to the objective part, and 20 points correspond to the essay section. You know that we are going to work on a weekly basis for the essay activities, which are 5 in total. So for the first part, the objective part, you will have 2 specific days at the beginning of December where you will upload your answers through EVA. You will have a link on EVA. This is going to be an automatic process that you will follow in order to answer the questions that you have in your at a distance assignment. So the idea is to make you work, to work on the activities by considering the previous aspects in order to avoid any confusion. You have to work during this week in the first activity. Next week we will continue with the second one, and so on, until finishing the 5 activities, which means that you are not going to leave everything or the essay part until the end of the course. You will have it ready by weekly, on a weekly basis, and the teacher will have the opportunity to provide the correct feedback in advance. You also should take an on-site evaluation, which is mandatory. This is going to be scored out of 60 points, and it's going to be related with the contents of the course, especially with the reflections that I mentioned, because we don't want you to memorize. You don't need to demonstrate that you memorized something or not. You need to demonstrate that you could understood a topic and that you are able to reflect, to put it into practice in the classroom. As an EFL teacher, I think all of us know the ways or the strategies we can adapt or we can use in the classroom to make a grammar lesson enjoyable for students. So the idea is for all of you in this on-site evaluation to demonstrate that part, and also it will have an objective section in which you will select through a multiple choice question each one of the answers that belong to the concepts of the course. Additionally, you will participate in the following mandatory activities. The teacher, in this case, you will work with me, is going to introduce the class, the course, and will share a forum for you to participate. As for this case, the forum will be posted tomorrow, And this is going to be scored out of 2 points. You will have 1 week in order to participate on it. However, it is not just posting one comment and that is all. You have to follow the other students' postings in order to make your own appreciations, to post more comments, to share ideas, information. Maybe if you find links or anything you want to share, you can use this tool in order to have your 2 points. Okay? Then we will continue with 3 chat sessions. These sessions are going to be scored out of 2 points in total. So 2 points divided by three chat sessions. These are mandatory. There's going to be a schedule that is going to be announced through Eva. And we will also work with some video collaborations scored out of 1 point each one of them. And finally, you will work on a wiki in which you need to collaborate and post information. You will work in groups with the students that are part of this class and about a topic that will be announced in the future. This is going to be scored out of 3 points. So if we have considered all the points that you can receive for these activities, there is a total of 10 points that are going to be considered, plus the previous ones, plus the 30 points and the 60 points that I mentioned before. So I hope this part is clear, because if these are mandatory activities, it means that you need to participate on them, that you need to be active, because in this way the student's role will be the most relevant for this class and for all of the classes that you will take in this master's program. Remember that studying at a distance requires commitment, and you need to try to be focused on participating on them, and not just participating and being connected, but you need to demonstrate your active participation there. So with these previous guidelines, the specific competences of the course are that you, as students, try to demonstrate a mastery of the theoretical perspectives on grammar, teaching, and learning. The student analyzes the current perspectives on teaching and learning grammar. The student is also able to evaluate the three-dimensional grammar framework of form, meaning, and use, as well as the tense and aspect system. And finally, to master the pedagogical options in grammar teaching. I think it really summarizes all the objectives and competences of the subject, which are related with the contents of the course that were presented at the beginning. In order to start with the first unit, remember we have divided it into 4, you are going to review in the additional resources and in the text guide some of the theoretical perspectives on grammar teaching and learning that have been used since years ago until nowadays. To do so, it's necessary to define what a language is. All EFL teachers, we need to know how to define it, because we are working with the language every day, we are teaching the language. And in this case, it's necessary to identify this concept, to understand this concept as something that constitutes a set of rules that can be present in the mind of a person unconsciously, which enables human beings to represent and communicate meanings by producing maybe audible, visible, or tactile symbols, that these rules systematically relate to those meanings. And the language has different branches, you know, the branches of linguistics. In this part, when we talk about, for example, audible, visible, and this kind of elements, we are talking also about the branches of linguistics that you know are phonology, phonetics, morphology. But not all of those branches are going to be studied in the course. Okay, so you need to identify which is the branch of linguistics that is going to be studied deep in a deep way in the course. Like in this case, it deals with, you need to know, okay? What is grammar? Another important part of the course is to identify, to be able to write a concept, your own concept. If you review all the elements, if you review concepts in different dictionaries, you will find that the most important ones are concentrated into the following. For example, that the grammar of a language can be understood to be a full description of the form and meaning of the sentences of the language, or else it may cover only certain various delimited parts of such description. Grammar is the study of the way words connect, the component parts, how they are combined to form a sentence. When we have been teaching grammar in the classroom, we usually apply this concept. We, even if we don't conceptualize it, but we are applying the concept. The study of structural relationships in language or in a language, sometimes including pronunciation, meaning, and linguistic history. Like in this case, according to the freedictionary.com, this is one important concept all of us need to know and to understand. Then, after working on the activities that are proposed in the guide, you will continue with this important classification related with grammar. How to differentiate this into descriptive and prescriptive? So, descriptive grammars denote the unconscious knowledge of a language. They do not teach the rules of a language, but rather describe the rules that are already known. In this case, the teacher does not explain the rules, okay? But maybe in some cases, rules are described, or the student knows the rules from the context. On the other hand, prescriptive grammars dictate what a speaker's grammar should be. They include teaching grammars which are written to help teach a foreign language. In prescriptive grammars, I would like to mention that in some cases, as native speakers, we know that a grammar structure is incorrect, but maybe we are not able to explain why is it incorrect. For example, we can say bananas I like instead of I like bananas. You know that the structure is incorrect, and in this case you need to be able to explain what's the reason why it is incorrect. However, in prescriptive grammars, they only dictate which is the correct way in which a grammar structure should be used. That's a big difference between both perspectives. Another important point is to differentiate covert and overt grammar teaching. Covert and overt grammar teaching have been used since years ago, and many authors have published about these important concepts. For example, Harmer, as cited in Sabatova, defined covert grammar teaching in the following way. The grammar rules are hidden from the students. It means that the teacher does not have to explain the structures, even though they are learning the language. Teachers may ask students to do any activity where a new grammar is presented, but their attention will be drawn to this activity, not to the grammar. So in this case, I need you to please focus your attention on identifying the reason or different activities that you can propose or think about related with covert grammar teaching. How to teach a grammar structure in a covert way, which means without explaining or without trying to differentiate the rules or to give the students tips to memorize the rules. This is the subject, this is the verb, this is the complement. No. In covert grammar teaching, you are not using that kind of strategies. However, you are helping the students to work with different activities in order to understand how the language works. Another point which is important is overt grammar teaching, in which grammatical rules are explicitly given to students. This is totally different to the previous aspect, because here the teacher focuses on explaining, on giving many details to students on how to form a structure. However, one of the difficulties of this kind of approaches is that the student does not have maybe the opportunity to add more elements to the structure and starts memorizing the rules. That's, you all of you know that memorization is not good, especially when you are working with beginner students, because they won't be able to produce in a meaningful way. In this case, the information is openly presented. All the information that the teacher wants to give students is presented, is explained. The teacher gives reasons about why a structure is incorrect, why the structure is not is correct maybe, and maybe the teacher also gives more examples about the ways you can form or students can form the specific structures. So these differences, as I told you, must be applied into practical activities that you will propose. You will reflect on these aspects by analyzing your own teaching situation, or maybe if you are not teaching at the moment, you can analyze, you can observe other teachers' classes in order to produce your examples. So here, in this first unit, we will also study the most relevant grammar approaches and theories. All of you know that there have been different methods, different strategies or approaches that have been used in the classrooms. And one of them was the grammar translation method. Was because it is now the communicative method is one of the most used. However, in the past, the grammar translation method, which is defined as a method of foreign or second language teaching, was used to make use of, to translate a lot. So the main focus of this method is translation, where students are giving activities that make them maybe just looking in a dictionary the meaning of a word and trying to complete activities based on that. However, still today, there are many teachers who use this method. I'm not telling you that the use of this method is incorrect or correct. It depends on the situations. It depends on the also on the teacher's profile, on the teacher's, and also on the student's profile and needs. However, I would like just to review them briefly because it's important that you focus your attention on understanding the main characteristics of each one of the approaches. So one of the things that needs to be studied here is that the grammar translation method relates with the translation of texts. It's applying rules to translate. Students usually try to memorize given phrases. That's why maybe the grammar translation method is not used today, or maybe it is not used a lot today. Learning vocabulary involves translating it from one language to another, which means the students are provided with a list of words in the target language with the translations to their native language. In this case, I think it's not so relevant because students are not able to produce more, just they start memorizing structures or simple words by giving definitions. Maybe if they are good at memorizing, they won't have any problem. However, when they have to be part of real productive situations in which they need to use the language, they won't be able to do it. Native language of the students is used very much in lessons, instructions, discussions, as well as in grammar explanations. So since the main focus of this method is not on making the students communicate a lot, the native language, in our case, for instance, Spanish, is allowed in the classroom. And if this language is allowed, it means that the students won't produce the target language in a meaningful way because they won't have maybe any opportunity to practice it. Let's continue with another important method, which is the direct method, in which the second language learning is considered as a similar language to the first one. So both are compared. In this case, there should be lots of oral interaction, spontaneous use of the language, no translation. Translation is avoided, on the contrary, as in the previous one. And in this case, little, if any, analysis of grammatical and syntactic structure is used, which means that this method gives priority to oral skills. The direct method is like comparing the way a child acquires the language, since maybe you have 3 years old or 4 years old, you start producing your own language. So this is compared to that important phase when you acquire your first language. Which are the most relevant characteristics? The use of the mother tongue is forbidden. So it means that Spanish is not going to be used in the classroom, as in our case, in our context. Each lesson starts with a dialogue or an anecdote. The use of pictures and actions help students to understand the meanings in an easy way. So, since we are trying to help them to produce, these kind of resources are also important and necessary. The inductive way is used in this approach. This way of learning is compared to the way in which a little child acquires its mother tongue, as I mentioned it before. The texts that are read in the class are not analyzed grammatically, but they are read for pleasure and for finding out some interesting information. Another point that is really different to the previous method, that the student in this case enjoys learning the language. And the target culture is taught in an inductive way. Another method, which is also important, is the audiolingual, in which the main principle lies in the learning of particular blocks of language, assuming that a human being can be trained using a system of reinforcement in a way that a correct behavior receives a positive feedback, while the errors receive a negative feedback. It has a direct relationship with Skinner's behaviorism theory, which is a topic that I like you to study, to research about it in order to understand this concept better. However, in the audiolingual method, as it mentions in the slide, it is assumed that a human being can be trained using this system of reinforcement. Maybe if the teacher gives the student a positive feedback about any of the activities he or she is working on, so the student will, in this case, continue improving, or maybe will be afraid of using the language. It depends on the way the teacher gives feedback to the student. So this is related with this theory, which was proposed by Skinner some years ago. Each lesson begins with a dialogue. And the language becomes a habit formation. That is why mimicry and memorization are used. Grammatical rules are taught in an inductive way and are sequenced. Skills are sequenced, for example, listening, speaking, reading, writing, postponed. It is believed that a more effective way of learning something is to present it orally first, then in written form. That's why it's called the audiolingual method, because it always gives priority to this kind of skills. First the oral part, and then the written form. The importance of correct pronunciation is stressed in this method, and it is important to prevent learners' errors, as they make bad habits in students. Maybe these kind of errors make students like fossilize a bad habit and to produce it every time without changing the way he pronounced the words. The language is often manipulated without any context or meaning. This is different to other kind of methods where context is the most relevant part. In this case, the teacher gives priority or emphasis to this kind of skills. What happens with the communicative approach? The communicative approach is a method that is used nowadays in all language classes. This is one of the approaches that teachers try to emphasize in the classroom, where the foreign language is seen as a means of communication that can allow students to say something in the target language, to find out some facts, maybe being able to express likes, dislikes, his or her feelings regarding a certain topic, and to be able to produce. During the classroom activities, the teacher encourages learners to use the target language as much as possible. That is why in this kind of method, the native language is forbidden. You cannot let your students use it for communication, even if they wanna do it, but maybe by emphasizing on different rules in the classroom, the student will try to use the language in a communicative way and to take advantage of that classroom space to produce more. Some of the most important materials that the teacher can use in this case are related with a variety of alternatives, because you will promote teaching all the different language skills, which means that the materials that you will choose as a teacher should be meaningful and should be also authentic, should be original. It means that they have to try maybe to change the way the student perceives the class. It focuses on language as a medium of communication by emphasizing production, which means orally or speaking. Maybe the students will have more opportunities to practice that part in the classroom, and also the receptive skill of listening, in which the student will have the opportunity to maybe listen, especially using a video, for example, but especially listening the way native speakers speak the language. That's the intention of this part. The teacher sets up a situation that the students are likely to encounter in real life. That is why context appears in this method. The teacher puts the student in a situation in which he has to analyze a certain content, to make decisions, to talk about a certain topic, to identify an answer. Maybe they start reading something and they have this situation that usually happens in real life in order to enjoy the way they are learning the language. So students use it in a variety of contexts and places, which means that maybe the teacher can organize some activities in which the students are not necessarily participating or producing in the classroom. They can go away, maybe walk around the campus of the places where you work, and try to use it in a variety of ways, not necessarily in the classroom. In this method, more emphasis on active modes of learning that include pair work and group work are given. It also uses topical items in which pupils are gonna be familiar with their own language. Seeks to use authentic resources, and it's much more pupil oriented, which means that here the central role of this process is the student. The student is the one that experiences, the one that works in groups, that works in pairs, that gets familiar with a topic and talks about it, that feels that is enjoying this learning situation in a meaningful way. So after analyzing each one of these methods, I have included some reflection questions in your text guide, which are going to be directly related with the ones you are going to find in the on-site evaluation, in which you need to reflect, maybe to try to give alternative solutions, to explain the way you decided something, or why you decided or you consider something is in this way or the other. For example, for this first unit, how would you incorporate the communicative approach in your grammar lessons? I can also ask you about any of the other approaches that were previously explained and that you will research about. Why is the study of grammar important in language teaching? So you need to give enough arguments in order to support your answers when working on the activities that were proposed in the guide, or also in your distance activities or in the on-site activities. Questions related with past experiences you have had in the classroom. Have you ever used the audiolingual method, for example? Has this approach been useful? So when giving an answer to these kind of questions, it's necessary to have enough details or give enough details ready and have them ready to support your answers correctly. In the same way, as I told you, that you have to post your comments in the forum and participate in your video collaborations and everything. So the idea of the previous explanation was that you just remember these methods that are very important, but that you try to relate them with the teaching of grammar. That's important, because here in this course we are not focusing on teaching reading, on teaching speaking, on teaching listening. We are focusing on the teaching of grammar structures, and the different ways or alternatives you can follow in order to make your students enjoy the language. You know that even for speaking, for listening, for reading, or for writing, you will always need to know how the grammar of the language is structured. And you need to be able to explain to your students the reasons why a certain rule is incorrect, is not correct, but not necessarily by explaining the student in an explicit way. So you need to find the alternatives that you can follow in order to make them enjoy. The idea is to demonstrate that you read the material, and that you are able to reflect and to propose your own activities. So for the first unit, for example, you will find that it has a direct relationship with the activities that were proposed in the essay sections, because you will always try to be original and according to your own experiences to propose the strategies that you will follow. There are not gonna be correct or incorrect answers. However, you need to support the reasons why you included those aspects in your responses. That's the only thing that I would like to tell you before moving on to the following unit. Okay, in the second unit, which deals with the current perspectives on teaching and learning grammar, we will talk about the deductive and inductive approach, which are necessary for EFL teachers nowadays. Let's start with the deductive approach, in which the information of the target language that we are teaching and all the rules are explicitly explained at the beginning of the class. In this case, the teacher explains and then proposes some exercises, some exercises, in order for the students to try to practice the language. This is the most important characteristic of the deductive approach, and the main principles are generally used in the classes where the main target is to teach grammar structures. Do you follow, what kind of approach do you follow when using this deductive method or deductive approach? It is very common nowadays to use a three-stage approach, in which first you present the structures Then students practice the structures and then they produce. So that is the PPP approach: presentation, practice, and production. In the first stage, students have an understanding of the grammar point that they are supposed to learn. Sometimes the teacher points out the differences between the first language and the second language, especially depending on the method the teacher is using, of one of the methods that were previously presented, or maybe on another method from the different ones you can follow right now. So the idea is that you learn how to differentiate the stages. And a stage in which you present, it doesn't matter the way you do it, but you present the grammar point to the student. In the second stage, students start practicing the structure by using oral drills and reading exercises, maybe from the book, from the student's book, from the workbook, additional or supplementary material that the teacher uses. But the idea is that they practice the structures they were supposed to learn. Finally, in a third stage, the students are given different opportunities in order to communicate. Here, the teacher promotes an automatic and accurate use, however, of the language. However, this is not always so easy, because with just a simple explanation about the structure and without having enough time to continue practicing, maybe the students are not gonna feel like confident in order to produce the language immediately. So this is something that takes time. However, the idea is to understand that the approach in this first deductive method is related with the three phases. On the other hand, in the inductive approach, the students are the ones that have to discover the rules themselves. According to Noonan, the inductive approach is a process where learners discover the grammar rules themselves by examining the examples the teacher gives. So the teacher does not explain details of the structure, does not give students tips on how to classify a grammar structure, or maybe to tell this is the subject, the verb, this is a pronoun, this is a preposition, or everything. In an inductive approach, it is also possible to use context for grammar rules. Context, you know, is relevant, is necessary when you don't want students just to memorize a rule, because they start learning from a context you give them related with real situations. Then students try to explore them in a text or an audio, rather than just having simple sentences to analyze. So the main difference between both approaches is that in the deductive one, the teacher explains the structures. However, in this approach, in the inductive one, the students discover the rules. Maybe the teacher is gonna help them by giving a clear context, by making them listen something, an audio, maybe watching a video, but they will also reach the objective, which is to learn grammar. However, we have faced some difficulties regarding this approach, because it is not always possible to use it in the classroom because of different reasons that are necessary to take into consideration. For example, the learner's profile and the teaching setting. When you have a group with maybe more than 30 students, or maybe when you have a small group with 6-10 students, you will find that it is different to apply each one of the concepts, each one of the approaches. For instance, in this method, students work in pairs or small groups to find the grammar rules, but when the number of students is too high, it is hard for the teacher to control learners while they work on the rules. So it depends. And this is also related with the activities you have to propose in your essays. Some activities that, depending on the teaching setting, that depending on the learner's profile are gonna be better for a group, while for another group are not gonna be the most appropriate. And you know that everything is the teacher's decision, but the decision has to be controlled, has to be correct in order to make students learn the language. But how can we incorporate the inductive approach in a grammar lesson? For example, let's choose the verb be. Regarding the three phases, presentation, practice, and production, there are some pre-task, while doing task, and post-task activities you can propose. For example, as a pre-task, you can get students copies of newspaper articles. Or you can ask students to find sentences that contain the be verb construction. Maybe in a newspaper, in a magazine, article, or anything. Then, while students are working on those pre-task activities, the teacher writes the sentences on the board. The teacher asks students to try to guess the relationship between the subject and predicate, for example. And finally, after doing this, the teacher presents the rules, which is different than explaining the rules first and then asking them to practice. So the idea is to make students first feel that they are engaged with the grammar structure they will learn, and after that they will continue with a practice. And finally, as a post-task in which students continue interacting or producing, the application of the form in students' writings, for example, students write about a certain topic in order to apply the rules they were learning, or write sentences using the structures learned. Then the teacher needs to give feedback to the students that follow these three important phases. So this is a good example on how to use the inductive approach in a grammar lesson. However, everything will vary regarding on your decision as an EFL teacher. So what are the main differences between both? The first one, as I mentioned, in the deductive one, the teacher overtly explains the rules. So the first thing the teacher does in the classroom is to start explaining the reason, maybe to compare it with the native language if it's necessary, to specify the use of, or maybe the exceptions of a rule, and provide specific examples if it is necessary. On the other hand, when we talk about the inductive approach, first the teacher provides specific examples or maybe a context in order to reinforce the language and ask students to infer or deduce the rule from the context, which are very different. So in the first one, first the explanation, in the other one, you start with examples, with a context, and then the students infer the target structure. Something that is really related with the way the teacher promotes learning grammar in students is the grammar in context approach, in which EFL learners are given just sentences which they are expected to internalize. How do they internalize them? By repeating, by practicing a lot, by working on different exercises. But unless they provide opportunities for learners to explore grammatical structures in context, they make the task of using the language for communication more difficult than it needs to be. It usually happens. That is why it is the teacher's role to maybe find good examples or good context in order to introduce the grammar structure to the students in a good way. Because if the context, for example, that was chosen by the teacher is appropriate for a higher level of students, maybe they won't have the opportunity to understand it. Or maybe if I'm working with advanced students and if I choose a context that can be used with beginners or intermediate students, it is not going to be appropriate for them. However, when we teach this important aspect, which is grammar, through context, we will help our students perceive the structures of the language in an effective way. It has been proved that context really helps them not to just to memorize something, but to feel that the information they are receiving is going to be useful in the near future, maybe in a practical situation, in a productive situation, where they have to use the language effectively. What are the main advantages of this approach? As I told you, it allows our students to see how rules can be used in sentences. It is important to make them feel the necessity of using the rules. It will also give our students an opportunity to understand how the language works, and this will improve their communication skills. Of course, if they have more opportunities to practice, and if they understand the way we form the structure or the language works, it will give them confidence to communicate in a good way. Context also gives a more precise understanding of how to use the grammar and provides accuracy in the studied language, both in oral and in reading skills. So the student will feel confident to write, also to speak, and not only will be in charge of receiving information, memorizing information, and no more. That is why, in comparison with the previous methods that we were analyzing in Unit 1, we notice here that this approach is really appropriate and it has a relationship with the communicative approach, because context is introduced to make students enjoy the language. Here you will find some of the most important differences. This graph has been also included in the text guide, in which you can differentiate both of them. That grammar in context focuses on form, meaning, and use. However, when we teach grammar in isolation, we will focus just on form and on meaning. So use is not really seen by a student as something that is going to be helpful for them in the future. So in the grammar in context approach, the main focus is language learning. However, on the other approach, in grammar in isolation, language acquisition is the central focus. Learning grammar requires a commitment to teach, and on the other hand, exercise involving repetition, manipulation, and grammatical transformation are some of the most relevant activities that the teacher uses there. Maybe repeating, manipulating, asking students to prepare a lesson about vocabulary, to memorize words, to memorize all the past tenses of maybe 60 verbs that can be found, memorize this rule, and that is all. However, in the grammar in context approach, the student, it's necessary that the student learns or memorizes something. However, the student will feel that he or she is able to produce, even if they don't memorize all the tenses, all the words, all the meanings immediately. However, by practicing them, they will feel confident to produce a lot. One of the most important theories that needs to be studied is related with cognitive linguistics. Why did I include this topic in your guide? Because nowadays, everything deals with the brain. We need to understand the way the brain works in order to learn a language. As in the same way as we were studying before, when we talk about first or second language acquisition, our brain or our neuro-linguistic system has an important, a very special role regarding language learning. For EFL learning, as in the case of our master's program, we need to be able to identify at least the most relevant concepts about cognitive linguistics. Why? Because later we will have just a little bit of, or we will try to identify some of the most important characteristics of cognitive grammar. Since cognitive grammar is directly related with cognitive linguistics, we will start by defining cognitive linguistics first in order to conceptualize cognitive grammar in another slide. So, cognitive linguistics has a relationship between the human language, the mind, and social physical experience. It focuses on natural language as a means for organizing, processing, and conveying information, and it assumes that our interaction with the world is mediated through informational structures in the mind. So we don't learn a language alone. Everything is mediated through the way we think. Everything is connected with our brain. So why does the concept of cognitive grammar appear here? From the perspective of cognitive linguistics, the major claim is that language is an integral part of cognition rather than an autonomous cognitive course divorced from other mental faculties. So maybe if a student has problems to understand a certain grammar structure, it is not just because the student doesn't want to participate or be responsible. Maybe there's going to be, or maybe something happens in his brain that makes this student feel that he's not able to produce the language. So regarding cognitive grammar, it's necessary to define it as symbolic in nature. It focuses on constructions rather than rules as the main objects of description. So when we refer, when we talk about cognitive grammar, we will focus not on rules, we will focus on constructions that have a meaning that can be meaningful for students. So all constructs posit for grammatical description, for example, a noun, a subject, a preposition, a past participle, any grammar tense, needs to be meaningful. That's the main difference regarding the other approaches. Meaningful for the students, which means that, for example, the noun, the subject, need to have a meaning for the student that is trying to learn the language. Cognitive grammar also claims that grammatical structure is almost entirely overt, which means that the teacher should explain the rules, since it embodies the conventional means a language employs for structuring and symbolization of semantic content. So it's necessary for the teacher to give the grammatical descriptions a certain meaning to make them meaningful for the student, and also to explain the students in another way all the structures that are going to be employed. What are the main assumptions of cognitive grammar? First, that it is part of human cognition, which means that human beings are able to understand structure. So it interacts with other cognitive faculties, especially with the perception, sense, with attention, and memory. The grammar of a language reflects and presents generalizations about phenomena in the world as its speakers experience them. Forms of grammar are like lexical items, meaningful, and they are never empty. Never empty. The grammar of a language represents the whole of a native speaker's knowledge of both lexical categories and the grammatical structures of the language. The grammar of a language is user-based in that it provides speakers with a variety of structural options to present their view of a given sentence. Maybe you can find these aspects a little bit difficult. However, the idea is not, as I told you, not to memorize these definitions, but just to understand the main concept of cognitive grammar. First, that it deals with linguistics, with cognitive linguistics, then that it is part of human cognition, and that it really interacts with the human being's faculties, with the perception that people has, with the senses, and that the idea of teaching the language, the idea of teaching grammar, can be meaningful and never empty. That's the central idea of the cognitive grammar approach. For this reason, this aspect gives cognitive abilities a very important place in linguistic theory because it relates language with general cognition. And finally, it's necessary to establish the main differences between the traditional grammar methods and teaching grammar in a cognitive way. This perspective is gonna be presented in the following chart, where you can find some differences between teaching in a traditional way and teaching in a cognitive way. For example, I'm liking the school much better now. In this case, the teacher just explains to the student the way the structure is formed, what is the function of each one of the words, and the verb, let's choose as example the verb like, is a stative verb. Students usually memorize what are the stative verbs, what are the exceptions with these verbs, but maybe it stops the process of learning. On the other hand, when we talk about cognitive grammar, we are talking about a meaningful situation for students, giving them the capacity to reflect. For example, I'm liking school much better now. In the same case, I can choose the verb like in order to explain to students the extended perfective sense of this verb, that this is a stative verb usually used with the progressive tense in order to talk about a lasting situation. The idea of cognitive grammar is also to use, for example, pictures or graphs to make students understand the language, or maybe if they are visual learners, to remember these concepts forever, not just in this, as in this case. This is a stative verb, and then the students forget, why was it here? So what do I say, I'm liking the school much better now? What's the reason why I'm saying it? This is the most important part in the classification about cognitive and traditional grammar. So it's necessary to use concepts to explain to students the main aspects of the language, or the, because this is a dynamic process that deals with cognitive linguistics. According to Effendi, the following rationale can be used if we want to plan a grammar lesson. For example, we can focus on the structure, function, and meaning. The language is going to be presented in a more meaningful way for students, which leads to meaningful learning for them. There have been some studies that have been published recently about cognitive grammar. This is one of the topics that are going to be investigated, maybe by some of you, while you review aspects on the internet, on digital resources, because this is a new topic that has to be incorporated in the classroom. Maybe we don't have enough experience about using it yet. However, the idea is to make students feel that the structures are really meaningful for them. I have included an important example with the being schema in cognitive grammar. For example, with the verb be, in the first one, this place on the map, here is the Sahara. In the first one we have the function of is like an identifier. In the second one, the Sahara is a desert, which is the function of the verb here, class membership. Is dangerous, attribution. The function of this is attribution. This is not an identifier, this is not class membership. This is in Northern Africa. This expresses location. And finally, the last one is existential. This is the meaningfulness you have to give students, especially for advanced students. I think it can work very well because you can make them connect their with the previous experiences they have had, maybe with their first language, and have a better idea about the language. This is going to be meaningful because you are not just telling them that here the function of is a verb, the be verb. This is the beer verb, the be verb, another example with be, this is another sentence, and that is. So students might have difficulties then if they don't know why, in this case, this is has a certain function, while in the last case, it has a totally different function. So that is helping students to understand the language in a meaningful way, especially regarding grammar. This is just one of the examples. You can propose your own. However, it can be harder at the beginning, but it is not so difficult. So you can enjoy working with this kind of exercises. Let's continue now with the questions for reflections that you have to answer. In your guide, in the second one, you have to ask yourself about some situations that are going to help you to reflect and to be prepared for your test. For example, the main differences between deductive and inductive approach. But as a teacher, which one of both approaches would you prefer to apply in the classroom? Differences between the cognitive and traditional grammar teaching. Can cognitive grammar be successful, a successful approach in the teaching of grammar? In which way? How? Always, you have to support your answers, to reflect them, and to try to look for additional information on different sources in order to make your answers a little bit harder, very, I think, you have to try to post good comments and very, very organized with a good style and everything there. As I told you, this is not difficult. However, you need to start reading a lot in order to have more ideas to support each one of them. In Unit 3, which is related with form, meaning, and use of the language, there are some activities from the essays that are related with these aspects. So, Sells, Murcia, and Larsen Freeman have established a three-dimensional grammar framework from which the relationship between grammar and communication can be established. This three-dimensional framework deals with these things: the meaning, form, meaning, and use. Form, which is directly related with the structure, meaning, which deals with semantics, and use deals with pragmatics. So the idea here is to differentiate each one of the topics and to apply them in your real examples. Briefly, we would like to explain what is form, which refers to the visible and audible parts of vocabulary, functional expressions and grammar units, for example, the spelling, phoneme, syllable stress, words in a phrase, etc. Meaning, what is the literal or essential meaning of the word, phrase, functional expression, or grammar structure? What does it mean in the context that I am teaching? So, not just explaining the form, but accompanying my explanation with the meaning of that phrase or the function of that phrase. This final dimension refers to the words, functional expressions, and grammar structures that we choose to use. And it always depends on the situation, on the aspect that we want to communicate to our listeners. It is interconnected with meaning, as in the previous concepts, always with meaning. In order to explore them, I would like just to tell you one of the examples. For instance, form of phrasal verbs that were chosen here to give you an example on how to differentiate the three aspects. Form of phrasal verbs. Phrasal verbs are two-part verbs comprising a verb and a particle. You have some examples there to look up. Sometimes they can be constructed with three parts in that a preposition can follow the particle to keep up with. So this is form. Form is just explaining the students the way they have to construct a structure in order to make it meaningful, in order to form a sentence, but you explain them the way they have to join words together to form a sentence. Meaning of phrasal verbs. We know that phrasal verbs vary a lot, and depending on the situation, they are going to have a meaning, or maybe this meaning will vary. There are literal phrasal verbs such as to hang up, for example, where if one knows the meaning of the verb of the particle or both, it is not difficult to figure out the meaning of the verb particle combination. If you know what the meaning is, for example, what's the meaning of hang or up, it is easy to figure out what it means. Regarding the use of phrasal verbs, you will notice that when is a phrasal verb preferred to a single word verb that conveys exactly the same meaning. Let's see the example. Put out a fire versus extinguish a fire. For the most part, phrasal verbs seem to be more common in informal spoken discourse as opposed to more formal written discourse. So in informal speaking situations, you can find these kind of examples, and you will find more examples in the text guide that are going to help you understand these differences better. So the idea is that teachers can organize the facts. By doing this, they can more easily identify where the learning challenge will lie for their students. This is, I think, one of the most relevant aspects here, because the function of the framework, why is it useful? Why do you think that teaching students the form, meaning, and use of the language is meaningful for them? Because in this way, you can find what are their learning needs. What do you need to reinforce? Maybe you need to focus more on form, on meaning, on use. It depends on the situation of your classes. All three dimensions should be mastered by learners, not necessarily in a conscious way. For this reason, identifying the challenging aspects is an important key which should be taken prior to grammatical teaching. That's very, very important. Regarding the tense and aspect system, many languages have grammatical means to indicate the time when an action or event occurs. The phenomenon is called tense. For example, you will notice here, and this is a very easy example, where you differentiate between the present and past of the verb work. Work or works, depending on the subject in this case, and worked, the past tense of the verb. So here, you easily know, if you identify the verb, if you are talking about a past situation or a present situation. You know the time when the action occurs. That is tense. However, aspect deals with the internal constituency of actions, events, states, processes, or situations. It also gives us information about, for example, is it a single event, a series of events over time, an action that is ongoing and likely to remain so? Aspects give you information on these actions, on the states, on the processes of the situations. For example, English typically uses the ing form of verbs to indicate ongoing processes, as in the sentence, he is studying French. You know that this is an ongoing process. You know the time where it is. So you, in this case, you are using aspect to in order to to make it different from the tense. You know that the action is ongoing in this case. According to Ham and Bot, there are four aspects in English that we need to differentiate in a good way. A simple aspect, a continuous aspect, perfect and perfect continuous aspect. Remember, these are not tenses. These are aspects, as it was mentioned before. The simple aspects express single actions, habits, and routines. A continuous or progressive aspect expresses an incomplete or temporary action, or an action that is in progress or still in progress at the time. A perfect aspect expresses the results of previous actions, and perfect continuous expresses incomplete or temporary actions or states that began before a specified time. So, if students can first be taught to associate the core meanings with the forms, then they can be helped to understand the more peripheral uses that are not easily explicable from a core meaning perspective. The idea is to know that the grammar teaching needs to be an integral process where you not just teach the rule or the form, where you also teach the meaning and the use of the structure and the different uses, tenses, and aspects that can vary, so that the EFL teacher needs to be ready to do so. So, finally, with this unit, some important reflections for you. Why is it important for teachers to teach the meaning of a grammar structure? Or maybe we can change this word by to teach the use of a grammar structure, or to teach the form of a grammar structure. The idea is to reflect on it. Why is it important for EFL teachers to teach the meaning of a grammar structure? How would you adapt the framework for meaning and use in your own teaching? So you have a variety of options to answer these questions. And finally, the last unit is related with grammar in language teaching today, that there are some pedagogical options in grammar teaching plus the ones that we just studied and analyzed that are really meaningful in the classroom. First, it's necessary to consider that teaching grammar means enable language students to use forms in a meaningful way, in an accurate way, and in an appropriate way. So, different structural syllables have been employed by teachers. And for example, the presentation, practice, and production approach is one of the most common today. On the other hand, it is necessary to add that communicative approach is one of the most used also by teachers. They prefer to use the communicative approach, starting with communicative activities or content-based material, and supporting it with practices that make students understand the language. If we analyze some of the examples about errors or form, meaning, and use, we can find different options you can follow in order to understand this topic. The teacher would recast the student's production accurately. For example, in this error or form, you can find it, the error there. This is Juan's notebook. There's an error there. So what the teacher has to do in this case, how does the teacher give, in this case, a student or a students a correct feedback? Perceiving the error to be the form of the possessive. So when the teacher immediately answers, oh, that is Juan's notebook here, this is not so direct feedback, but the teacher is explaining a little bit the reason why it was or there was an error or form in the sentence that the student produced. Errors of meaning, there are different errors of meaning. That, for example, the teacher would recast what the student has said in a meaningful way. I need to look at the word in the dictionary. So the teacher recast it. You need to look up the word in the dictionary. And as you can see, the teacher is perceiving the phrasal verb look up to be a better form for what the student said. So this is a good way of giving the student feedback in relation with meaning, with an error of meaning. And an error of use, which is one of the most important, I think, the teacher would recast what the student has said in an appropriate manner, in an appropriate way. For instance, I arise at 6 in the morning. There's an error of use there. Where is it? In this verb. The teacher immediately gives feedback by telling, okay, you get up at 6 in the morning, perceiving that a phrasal verb would be more appropriate to convey the student's intended meaning. Not necessarily by changing the tense. Notice here, it depends on the students, especially on the level of the students. But how do we teach nowadays, implicitly or explicitly? There are two important teaching methods that we as CFL teachers have been discussing about. Since we usually see grammar as the backbone of languages and learners should be presented with explicit or explicit grammar. In this respect, let's see that the context or the situation are the ones that will help you decide which is the most appropriate method. In implicit teaching, for example, learners acquire the language without any overt grammar instruction. So teachers believe that conscious use of language forms may result in poor language proficiency and fluency. And that is why they, in this case, try to get the students involved. Teachers prefer language use to language usage and focus on meaning rather than focusing on form of the language. They also can provide specific activities, tasks, students can work there in order to discover the meaning of this authentic language without talking about rules or forms at all. So it's necessary to have it very clear, because now we will have different concepts that can help you understand the topic. Teachers who focus on language forms presentation, they usually hold a traditional view of teaching the language explicitly. They usually explain the grammar rules and practice through drilling. So as in the previous methods that we explained, first an explanation, then some practice. However, this way of teaching the language can of course affect the students' proficiency, because they won't be able to notice or maybe to correct forms on exercises and tests. They will continue making errors, making mistakes, and that's gonna be hard then for the teacher to try to solve. Students who learn English under this form of instruction know a lot about the language, but they are unable to use it appropriately in contextualized situations. That is one of the characteristics of this method, in which students can feel that they are not able to produce the language alone. But what are the main differences between implicit and explicit learning and implicit and explicit instruction? In the first one, target the corresponding types of learning and learners' perspective and experience. In the second one, reflect the instructor's perspective and intentions. It deals with cognitive grammar. However, this is very important to focus our attention on the way the students learn, because one thing is to teach the language explicitly or learn it explicitly from an explicit instruction. On the other hand, it is different to receive this instruction in an implicit or explicit way. As I told you, the first one is highly intuitive and mostly procedural. It is accessed in automatic processing, while the other one is typically conscious and mostly declarative. It is accessed in control processing. Another topic is planning a grammar lesson. Why is it important? Why do you need to plan before going to the classroom, which is a relevant topic? So, important things that you need to remember: that having a lesson plan is always necessary because it helps you maintain a good focus in the classroom. It helps you keep you on track and keeps your students on track because you are having a specific detail or time estimated for each one of the activities. Lesson plans let you show off what you have taught, of course. They give you not just a sense of accomplishment, but something tangible that reflects that accomplishment. And each lesson plan sets a discrete, achievable goal that is going to help you when teaching the target language. There is no universal structure for a plan, especially for teaching grammar or for incorporating a grammar lesson in your classroom. However, according to this official blog, Making a Difference, there are four specific steps we can follow while planning: bookkeeping info, target language materials, and a step-by-step chronological list of things to do in the class. Very important. Each stage of the lesson should include a description of what you will do and what the students should do, a classification according to the previous stages, presentation, practice, or production. So what do I need to follow in the presentation stage? What are the exercises that are going to be incorporated in the practice section and in the production one? And the estimate time that you will need in order to work with the students. How long should this stage take? There are several factors, however, that we need to consider. For example, usefulness and relevance of the language. Students' learning needs, their styles and preferences, what are the difficulties that they can face while learning the language, depending on the learner's characteristics, of course. Maybe if our students have disabilities, that's going to be really, really hard for the teacher to differentiate between the group that doesn't have any disability, and maybe if you just have one student with a learning disability, You need to plan activities that are gonna be focused just for that student, for example. And finally, the importance of preparing a funny, meaningful, and memorable lesson. Another point that is necessary is the way we incorporate technology in the classroom. All of us know that nowadays, wikis, blogs, virtual platforms, YouTube, grammar websites, and many, many tools can be used in the classroom. There are many grammar websites that are specific to teach our students grammar, virtual games that can be useful in the classroom, many tools like Skype, social networks, among others, that can be discovered by both the teacher and the student and have excellent advantages for you as grammar teachers, as English teachers, but of course you can emphasize on the teaching of grammar here because there is material nowadays that is available in a free way for all of us. So when planning your lesson, especially if you have the tools in the institutions where you work, or maybe to teach just one of your students, you can apply any of these tools to make the grammar, the learning of grammar, enjoyable. This is a meaningful method of teaching and assessment that incorporates the productive skills of writing and speaking. Remember that nowadays we have different tools, especially for writing and speaking. You can maybe record a video or just the voice of your students, or check the writing through online tools without the necessity of being there face to face with them. So you can take advantage of these tools in your planning. And before moving on to the next slide, I just want to mention that in one of the activities that you will need to work on, of the essay ones, you need to incorporate technology or technology tools that are going to be helpful in your lessons. So it's necessary not just to mention, I will use Wiki or a grammar website, but you need to tell me which is the website you will use it, the link of the website, and why is it important for your lesson, especially by giving details on how you adapt the technological tools in your teaching. So there are many problems that our students can face while trying to internalize the grammar structure, because grammar is something that really is not so welcome for all students. Maybe some of them can be afraid. And the problem for EFL teachers is that there is a time lag between the awareness of such changes and their appearance as the proper use of the language. Because students usually see that it is difficult for them to learn the structure. However, even we have found many, many difficulties regarding grammar, EFL teachers should always be ready to propose and analyze solutions to the problems they encounter in the classroom. In this case, the teacher can choose between helping the student with a traditional explanation or using context to explain the grammar structure. However, considering the students, this is the teacher's decision, but it's necessary to consider the student's profile and the student's needs in order to propose good solutions for the educational problems you might find in the classroom. So how to overcome this kind of difficulties? There are many difficulties, of course, in education, in the teaching of English, in the teaching of EFL. However, it's necessary always to reflect in order to propose good solutions. So it is better to think of teaching grammaring. What does it mean? The addition of ing to grammar is meant to suggest a dynamic process of grammar using. In order to teach this goal, it is not sufficient for students to notice or comprehend grammatical structures. Students must also practice meaningful use of grammar in a way that takes into account transfer appropriate processing. In this case, not just the structure. However, why is the structure meaningful? As in cognitive grammar, it was mentioned, not just to explain the rule, but the adding of ing is to suggest that this can be more dynamic. Grammar is a skill to be mastered, not just a set of rules that need to be memorized. We will be helping our students in this way to go a long way toward the goal of being able to accurately convey meaning in the way they want. So Larsen Freeman called EFL teachers for helping students develop the capacity not just to develop their formal grammatical competence, but if we want to develop their capacity, it means that we have to choose between the different approaches and methods we have in order to make this teaching meaningful. Capacity involves learners using lexicogrammatical resources for the creation of meaning. In this way, learners are going to be able to move beyond the memorized formulas and just rules, and they will be able to employ them in a special way at the beginning of instruction. Finally, one of the topics that needs to be included here is how to test grammar. You know that there are different ways of testing grammar. Testing is typically done by means of the contextualized discrete points items, such as sentence and scrambling, fill in the blanks, error correction, complete this sentence, combine this sentence, or describe this picture. There are different ways, however, not all of them are usually appropriate for the objective of the lesson you have. The idea here is that it is not so good to test just the grammar knowledge, even that if it's necessary to demonstrate that the student has understood the grammar structures. However, it's not always necessary to test them based on maybe complete the sentence or fill in this blank, because it maybe won't promote a student's accuracy in the language. So there is a variety of alternatives. In this case, there is a model that Rhea Dickens, as cited in NOSA 2013, promote. The five characteristics to measure communicative grammar. First, the test must provide more context than only a single sentence. This is important. Context, as we have been discussing in this presentation. The test taker should understand what the communicative purpose of the task is. But before the student understands, first the teacher needs to explain the situation. He or she should also know who the intended audience is. It means that EFL teachers should know what kind or what are the characteristics of our students before starting implementing tests. He or she must have to focus on meaning and not form to answer correctly. Recognize is not sufficient. The test taker must be able to produce grammatical responses. So it means that in a paper-based test, for example, it is not just necessary to make students recognize a rule, but by incorporating, for instance, an oral practice in which the student uses the grammar structures, it's gonna be more effective and meaningful for the students. EFL teachers should bear in mind the rules that are offered by Harmer. Do not test what you have not taught. This is important. Do not test general knowledge or memorization. Do not introduce new techniques in tests, which means that we have to avoid proving a new technique or a new method for testing. We want, in this case, to focus our attention on those techniques that are known by students. Do not just test accuracy. And finally, do not forget to test the test, which means a validation process in which the teacher gives the test to a peer in order to correct possible errors that might be there. And finally, the reflection questions that I incorporated here are, for instance, can implicit and explicit knowledge be considered the products of the process of implicit and explicit learning? What kind of learning difficulties have your students faced while learning grammar? What are the main benefits of planning a lesson in advance? Why does grammar teaching enable language students to use linguistic forms meaningfully, accurately, and appropriately? And this is the methodology that we will follow in this course. So this is the end of the presentation, and this is time for questions. If you have to ask me anything about the course, I am ready to help you in this moment. Thank you very much.